that we are starting off Krishna's pastimes today, and this will be our main topic, main discussion now. Like, we have covered different activities, different pastimes, different pastimes of the Lord and his devotees. And what did we learn from those pastimes? We learned from those pastimes that devotion to Krishna is the ultimate goal of life. And one thing I was very much emphasizing the other day, when Vritrasura was cursed, Chitraketu was cursed by Parvati, what did Lord Shiva tell her? Not perturbed by any of these situations. And that is the important thing to remember. And also another point came up from Draupadi's episode, that these pastimes of Lord is actually indicating that surrendering to the Lord gives us the greatest safety. And the Lord proves that time and time again. And I read out, things take place, but that simply enhances the loving relationship. In this respect, I often think of one thing is that the father, sometimes don't the father throw the little baby up? It looks like the father is throwing the baby. But then the father catches the baby, and when the father throws the baby gets into anxiety. Right? But then when the father catches the baby, then the baby laughs, the father laughs. So that act of throwing the baby up in the air may appear to be a dangerous situation, but this is a way to experience that joy of catching the baby in the mid-air. So in a similar way, we can consider from time to time, Krishna may put us in that kind of situation. And at that time, should we tell Krishna, "Krishna, why did you put me in that situation?" If we question that, then Krishna will say, "Okay, then I'm not going to catch you." Therefore, our business is simply to depend upon Krishna. And I'm sure everybody goes through these situations. And the more we go through these kind of situations, the better it is for us. And we are seeing through these episodes that devotees' lives are not always strewn with the bed of roses. Devotees are put into difficulties, so many difficulties. Look at what happened to Prahlad Maharaj. His own father is making him go through all these extremely dangerous situations. So that way we see how Krishna is the ultimate shelter. We are not in Krishna consciousness to have a pleasant, peaceful life strewn with bed of roses. But we are in here, to learn how to depend upon Krishna and experience the joy and also the safety of depending upon Krishna. So now we are coming to direct Krishna's pastimes, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. This is the most important chapter of Srimad Bhagavatam, the 10th canto. The 10th canto is considered to be the body, the tenth canto has been considered to be the smiling face of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Srimad Bhagavatam is the body of the Lord. First two cantos are the legs. The third and fourth cantos are the thighs of the Lord. Fifth canto is the abdomen of the Lord. Sixth canto is the chest of the Lord. Seventh and eighth cantos are the hands of the Lord. Ninth canto is his neck. And tenth canto is his smiling lotus face. I just remembered one thing. The other day before yesterday, I told Subhadra Sundari, who doesn't understand Hindi, that I'll make some arrangement for her to, for someone to translate to her. So any volunteer? Okay. I thought of Shampiari actually. Go, Shampiari, you can. Yeah, Radha Pyari was not there at that time. Okay, she is sitting there. Renu, raise your hand. There she is. Thank you, Shampiari. Her daughter Renu speaks French also. I mean, Renu speaks Hindi also, but she was telling me that her Hindi was not good enough to translate. And although she's a linguist, she speaks English, she speaks French, she speaks Bhojpuri. Hindi. She's from Paris. And so, okay. So now Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Krishna mentioned in Bhagavad Gita, yada yada hi dharmasya glanir bhavati bharatah abhuthanam adharmasya tadatmanam shijammaham. Whenever there is a decline, adharma, wherever there is an increase of irreligiosity and dharmasya glani, there is a decline of religious principles. Religious principle goes down and irreligiosity prevails. Meaning, the law and order turns upside down. The law and order, which is dharma, people don't act according to the dharmic principles, don't act according to the Lord's instructions. They give up, they totally disregard the instructions of the Lord and act in total defiance of the arrangement of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Just as in a kingdom, if the law and order is in disarray, what will the king do? Will the king allow that to continue? Or the king will intervene, come with, either send his army to take care of the, or police to take care of the miscreants, or he himself will go. And like in this respect, I often think of the situation in Singapore when Singapore became the nation. Previously, Singapore was a part of Malaysia. But then Singapore became separate. And the Lee Kuan Yew, did I pronounce the name all right? Lee Kuan Yew. Okay. Lee Kuan Yew became the ruler, the prime minister of the country. And prior to that, Singapore was the den of the lawbreakers. It was a den of mafias and all kinds of very, very
undesirable activities used to go on, you know, massive drug trafficking, massive smuggling, massive, you know, like mafiosi. And Li Kuan Yew then gave them 7 days. He said, surrender your arms and surrender the contraband things like drugs and all. 7 days. If you don't, and if you're caught, be prepared for the consequences. And those who did not, you know what happened? Anyone found with an illegal arm was given death sentence. Anyone found with illegal ammunition, death sentence. No, I'm sorry, life imprisonment. Anyone found with drugs, intoxicants, illegal intoxicants, death sentence. So much so that, like, anyone littered on the street, like if you dropped even a piece of paper on the street, immediately fine of a large sum, like $50 or something. And I heard people used to walk on the road. There was no respect for law and order. So instead of walking on the footpath, they used to walk on the road. And so he had kind of vehicles with spikes sticking out. So if somebody was walking like that, those vehicles, like rickshaws or something, like, and that would hit them, those spikes would hit them to make them sure realize that this is not the place to walk. That's the place to walk. So much so that, I mean, that's like when you go to Singapore, before you land, there is an announcement that if you are carrying any kind of intoxicants and drugs, please don't take it in the country because the penalty is death sentence. A few years back, 2 Australian girls were caught with some intoxicants. Gave death sentence. And there was a huge upheaval all over the world, an appeal from all the countries. But the government didn't budge. This is our law and we are going to stick to the law. And the result is Singapore is one of the most peaceful countries in the world. Most well-organized state in the world. So this is how the law, it is the responsibility of the heads of the states to take care of the law and order. Law and order. Order comes by establishing law. And how do you establish law? Crime and punishment. If there is crime, there is punishment. Then no one will break the law. I think the other day I was mentioning about Afghanistan. In Afghanistan, they have a law that if anyone is caught stealing, then his right hand is chopped off. This is just to mention about just one of the one of the things. And so one English journalist was writing about his experience in Afghanistan, and so he just exclaimed, "Oh, what a terrible punishment." But his friend, Afghan friend, who was actually telling him about that, he said, "But you have been in Afghanistan for so long. Did you see a single person with his hand chopped off?" So when the order, law is so strictly established, then no one will dare to break the law. So in a similar way, in this world, Krishna establishes the law, and that law is called dharma. So when people don't abide by that law, then Krishna himself comes and he takes care. So through Krishna's pastimes, that point becomes very, very clear. He caused so many people to die. And who are those people? Like just in 18 days' time, about something like, I can't even remember what the number is, few million people were dead in 18 days' time. They are in the battlefield, they're fighting the war, and they are killed. Okay, Jarasandha attacked Mathura 17 times. And mind you, in Kurukshetra battle, the total number of army, total number of military force was 18 Akshauhini. Whereas after Kamsa was killed, Jarasandha, who was his father-in-law, Kamsa attacked Krishna or Mathura 17 times, and each time he came with the army of 23 Akshauhini, like much larger than the army that gathered in two sides. Pandava side had 7 Akshauhini, Kaurava side had 11 Akshauhini. Whereas Jarasandha came with 23 Akshauhini soldiers, 17 times, and Krishna wiped it out, 17 times. And in this respect, the question came up, and each time Krishna let Jarasandha go. He wiped out his entire army, but he let Jarasandha go. So the consideration was, question is, that why Krishna spared Jarasandha? Why didn't he kill Jarasandha? The answer is, actually Jarasandha was Krishna's recruiting agents. Jarasandha was Krishna's recruiting agent, and he was collecting all these demons and bringing them to Krishna to slaughter. So that Krishna didn't have to go himself. So Jarasandha brought them to Krishna and Krishna wiped them out. So this is how Krishna takes care of the miscreants. And by annihilating the miscreants, eventually Krishna establishes the law and order and creates a peaceful situation in this material nature. So a situation became like that at one point. The demoniac kings became so powerful and they created their army to rule over and control the affairs of this world so much so that Mother Earth became so burdened. She couldn't tolerate that anymore. She was completely afflicted. She was completely agonized. So she approached Lord Brahma. Please do something about it. Look at my condition. Look at what they're doing to me. So then Brahma saw that he actually cannot rectify that situation. So he admitted that, look, it's beyond my control. These individuals who are creating this chaos all over the world, I cannot really take care of them. So let's go to the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who is lying in the milk ocean. So Brahma went to the Lord Kshirodakshayi Vishnu, who lies in the milk ocean, along with that cow, Mother Earth in the form of a cow, and the demigods. And there he prayed to the Lord, reciting the mantra called Purusha Shukta. And understanding Brahma's concern and Brahma's prayer, Brahma's appeal, the Lord communicated with him without appearing in front of him. In his heart he conveyed the message, "Don't worry, Brahma, I'm coming. I will come and you tell all the demigods to take birth in the Jadu family." So Brahma conveyed that message to all the demigods, and the demigods took birth in the Jadu family at that time. And in the meantime, Devaki got married to Vasudev. Vasudev is a very, very pious personality. Very wonderful personality, very wise, very self-controlled, and very generous, very wise. And when they were getting married, Kamsa, who was actually the ruler of all these, the leader of all the demons, he defeated all the demons, and all these demons became subordinate to him. He's an extremely powerful person. And he was actually the son of a demon. His father actually is a very wonderful person. He was the king of Mathura. His name was Ugrasen. Ugrasen, although his father was such a pious person, but Kamsa was a demon. How did it happen? Once, Kamsa's mother, Ugrasen's wife, Padmavati, was strolling in a beautiful garden, and at that time a demon called Drumila saw her and became enchanted by her beauty. And this demon had the power to change himself and assume some other form. So he, being attracted by her, assumed the form of Ugrasen, her husband, and approached her and molested her. And as a result of that, she became pregnant, and the result was this demon Kamsa was born. In a way, the son of Ugrasen, but he was actually not his son. And that's why he didn't develop his father's qualities, but he developed the demoniac qualities. So Kamsa was very affectionate towards his cousin. And Kamsa's relationship with Devaki was, Ugrasen's brother was Devak, and Devak's daughter was Devaki. So Devaki got married to Vasudev, and when and Kamsa himself was driving the chariot in order to display his affection towards his sister, to her husband's home. Vasudev and Devaki were in the chariot and Kamsa was driving. And then an announcement was heard from the sky. A voice spoke that, "Kamsa, do you know that the sister that you are carrying so affectionately to her husband's house, their eighth son is going to kill you." Just by hearing that, you can see, like, Kamsa was immediately transformed. In one hand, he was so affectionate to his sister, he was carrying her to her in-law's house. And as soon as he heard that her son is going to kill him, He immediately caught Devaki by her hair with his left hand. With his right hand he pulled out his sword and he was about to chop off her head. Vasudeva was very wise. He also heard that announcement. And this kind of announcement is called Daivavani or Akashvani. The announcement from the sky or the announcement made by the demigods. So he also heard, but he said, look, Kamsa, you are such a hero. Everybody worships the whole, all over the world, you are known for your heroism. And now if you kill your own sister, it'll be such a blemish in your character. And after all, why are you so worried about your death? Because death is born along with the birth of the person. Life actually is a continuous progress towards death. Nobody can avoid his death. And as one acts accordingly, he creates his next body. Just as when we walk, we take one step, and when that step is securely established on the ground, then we take the next step. And the other foot moves forward. Then that foot is established on the ground, then the other foot moves forward. So this is how a living entity progresses life after life, from one body to another body. So why worry so much about death? Like, on the other hand, you should be concerned about your reputation. And he said, anyway, it is the eighth son is going to kill you. So why kill Devaki? Devaki's eighth son is going to kill you. So I promise that as the children are born, I'll bring them to you and you can do whatever you want to do with them. Kamsa knew that Vasudeva was a very truthful person. So Kamsa said, okay. He liked the idea. He is not going to blemish his own reputation, heroic reputation. At the same time, purpose will be served. When the eighth son is born, I will kill him. And so in this way, Kamsa let Devaki and Vasudev, spared Devaki and Vasudev. They went back. In course of time, a child was born. And true to his word, Vasudev took the child, took it to Kamsa. Kamsa was impressed. He knew that Vasudev was a very truthful person. But he could also recognize that what it takes for a father to bring his newborn baby to somebody when he knows that he is going to kill him. So this is Vasudev, perfectly situated in the mode of goodness. Actually, Vasudev, the word Vasudev means Vishuddha Sattva, pure goodness. And Krishna appears in pure goodness. That's why Krishna appeared as the son of Vasudev, the personification of pure goodness. In pure goodness, one does not have any selfish consideration. He is perfectly situated in transcendental nature. So Kamsa was impressed and he was touched by this act of Vasudev. So Kamsa said, look, I have nothing to fear from this child of yours. So take him back. He's the eighth son that I should be afraid of. So, although Vasudev knew that it was nice, although he was happy that Krishna, that Kamsa didn't kill that child, but he also knew that a person like Kamsa cannot be trusted. Because their attitude may change at any moment. He already saw what happened to him, what happened to how Kamsa changed. When he was bringing them after marriage, in one hand he was showing so much affection to Devaki. But immediately, as soon as he heard that voice from the sky, his nature changed, his attitude changed. He is about to kill her. So anyway, Vasudev couldn't trust Kamsa, but Kamsa spared the child. And then Kamsa, in the meantime, Narad Muni came to Kamsa. And Narad Muni told Kamsa, Kamsa, look, the demigods have made this arrangement. They are already born in different Jaduda families. The demigods have taken birth. And this is all a ploy, an arrangement to kill you. So Vasudev's son, 8th son, is going to kill you. But did you ever consider the 8th son from front back or back to front? So any son can be counted as 8th son. So don't take any chance. Kamsa was really perturbed. And he saw some sense in Narad Muni's statement. The question arises, why did Narad Muni do that? Isn't it? Why did Narad Muni do that? Actually, what happened is, when the demigods saw that Kamsa spared the firstborn, the demigod got worried. Because when the child survives, the mother takes a long time to conceive the next baby. But if the child dies, then very quickly the mother conceives. So they were telling Narad Muni, please do something about it. Like, let Krishna come quickly and get rid of Kamsa. So that's why Narad Muni came and gave this advice to Kamsa. So that all these children should be killed right after their birth, and then Krishna will appear. So that's why Narad Muni did that. Anyway, so then upon hearing Narad Muni's statements or advice, Kamsa thanked Narad Muni. Thank you so much, Narad Muni, for being such a well-wisher of mine. And then Kamsa got that child, killed the child, just taking the child and throwing the child onto the stone floor, and arrested Devaki and Vasudev, put them in the prison. So that he can make sure that their children are killed right after their birth. Now there is another aspect of this divine arrangement. Kamsa in his previous life was Kalnemi, a demon. And his anyway, let's not get into all that. These the point is, actually I was thinking that let's stick to Krishna's thing. Let's not sidetrack because it takes up. Anyway, their Kalnimis, sons were Kirtimantas. Six sons, and they were performing austerities to become the king. And that was Hiranyakashipu's time. And Hiranyakashipu cursed that you'll be killed by your own father. And these Kalnemi, these six sons, became Kirtimantas, and the demigods made arrangements for the sons to come and be born as Devaki's children. And that's why it was Kamsa was killing them one after another. It was the arrangement of the it was the divine arrangement of the Lord. So they were killed, actually it was a result of their previous curse. Anyway, so let's come back to the main topic. So one after another, six sons were born and they were killed. Then Baladev came as the seventh son in the womb of Devaki, Shankarshan. And when he was 7 months old in the womb of Devaki, Krishna told Mahamaya to transplant Devaki's womb into Rohini's womb. Rohini was another wife of Vasudev. Being troubled by Kamsa, so many of Vasudev's relatives and wives ran away to different paths to avoid Kamsa's persecution. And Rohini was in Braj, in Vrindavan, in the house of Nanda Maharaj. And on the seventh month of the pregnancy, Shankarshan or Balaram, the seventh pregnancy, was transferred to Rohini's womb. But to Kamsa, it seemed that Devaki had a miscarriage. So the general belief was that Devaki had a miscarriage. The seventh child was a miscarriage, and Balaram appeared as the seventh son, and she was transferred to Rohini's womb. Then, as the eighth son, Krishna came. Kamsa could recognize that something is happening now. He saw that after conception, Devaki became so beautiful. She became so effulgent. She looked so divine. So Kamsa could suspect that now Vishnu has come as the sun. In one hand, Kamsa was very, very worried. But at the same time, Kamsa started to consider what happened, what to do. Kamsa did not want to kill Devaki. He was afraid. He did consider about killing Devaki, but at the same time he was afraid. So he considered, let the child be born and then I'll kill the child rather killing Devaki. He was waiting. And this time so much caution was taken. They were not only in a prison, but the arrangement was made that nobody would be able to come near the prison. Even the animals, the birds, could not fly over the prison. But in spite of all that arrangement, the demigods came and started to offer their prayers to Krishna in the womb of Devaki. Beautiful prayers. My Lord, now you have come, and we feel so reassured that you have come to deliver us. from our suffering condition. And in due course of time, the baby was born. The child was very beautiful and very unusual. He appeared with his four-armed form. And Vasudeva and Devaki's heart was filled with parental affection. But at the same time, they became afraid that this beautiful child has been born, but now Kamsa will come and kill him. So then the Lord assured them, don't worry. I have come here to kill Kamsa. Nobody can kill me. That miscreant is now going to be taken care of. And he suggested that take me to the house of Nanda Maharaj on the other side of the river, Jamuna. Mother Yashoda also gave birth to a daughter. So you place me and pick the daughter up and bring the daughter back here. And at that time, the chains that bound Vasudev automatically fell off from his hands and feet. The doors of the prison became wide open. All the guards and the sentries fell asleep. Vasudev picked up the child and walked out of the prison. And there was a torrential rain. And Ananta Shesha appeared there and spread his hood over Vasudev's head to protect him from the rain. When Vasudev came to the river, he found that the river was in full spate, completely. The water was flowing with a tremendous current. And the water was overflowing from the end, from the banks. And he became worried how to cross the river. But then he saw a small jackal. Jackal's height is about this high. Came and started to walk in front of him across the river. So Vasudev felt, wow, the river is not that deep. This jackal, this fox is walking. So he also started to follow the jackal. And it was true, it was the water was only ankle deep. But when he came to the midstream, then all of a sudden the baby fell out of his hand. And the current was so strong and he was in total anxiety. Where to find the baby? Where did the baby go? And he started to look for the baby and he couldn't find the baby. And naturally, by this current, the baby must have been swept away. Vasudev started to cry. But then all of a sudden, he touched the baby, picked him up. What happened? Jamuna Devi felt Krishna came so close and I won't get a chance to play with him. And as a result of that, Krishna fell out of his hand and Jamuna played with Krishna for a while and then went back to Vasudev's lap. Vasudev came to the house of Nanda Maharaj. It was midnight, past midnight. Everyone was fast asleep. Even Mother Yashoda was fast asleep. And he went to the room and he found there's a beautiful little baby girl. So he placed Krishna next to Mother Yashoda and picked up the baby girl and came back to Mathura. And as soon as he came back, he put the chains on his hands and feet, the doors closed, the baby started to cry, and all the sentries woke up. They immediately ran up to Kamsa. The child has been born, the child has been born. Kamsa, although he was waiting for this time, for this news, but as soon as he heard that, he started to shake out of intense fear, and uncontrollable fear overpowered him. He had long hair. The warriors carry long hairs like the Sikhs do. They don't cut their hairs because the hair acts as a helmet, hair and turban. And his long hair stood up out of fear. And he ran to the prison, and he saw this girl. Devaki appealed to him, "Look, Kamsa, there is nothing to be afraid of this girl. The announcement was the eighth son will kill you, not this baby girl. So please spare him." But Kamsa was so cruel that he didn't pay any heed to Devaki's appeal. He picked up the child and he was about to smash the child on the stone floor. But this child slipped out of his hand, assumed her eight-armed form of Jogamaya, went up to the sky and said, "Kamsa, do you think you can ever kill me? Rather, the one who is going to kill you has already appeared. It's only a matter of time before he takes care of you." And Kamsa felt very remorseful, very repentant, and begged forgiveness from Devaki and Vasudev. "So I'm so sorry for causing you so much trouble, being so cruel towards you. Please forgive me." So Vasudev and Devaki, as an ideal Vaishnav, immediately forgave him. Said, "It's all right, Kamsa. Everything happens by the arrangement of the providence. We are not the doers. We are simply puppets in the hands of the providence. We are mere puppets in the arrangement of guna and karma." So Kamsa went back, very thoughtful, very worried, and extremely afraid. So his associates and generals came to him and said, "Kamsa, it's not befitting you to become like this. Why are you afraid? Look at your power. You have controlled, you have brought all the powerful individuals in this planet under your control. Those who have surrendered to you, they have become your associates. And those who didn't surrender, like those demigods, they're always shaking, trembling in fear out of your prowess. And they're hiding in different corners of the world. So why should you be afraid? Okay, the announcement is, you have been told that the child is born. So do one thing. Kill all the children that are born within 10 days' time." And so they went and started to kill all the newborn babies. Wherever a child was born, they were killed. And another person who was actually engaged in this arrangement of killing, was Putana, an expert killer. She used to go and suck the life out of newborn babies. And she was also very fond of eating their flesh. Rakshashi, Putana Rakshashi. So Putana heard that Nanda Maharaj also gave birth to a son. So she decided to go and take care of this boy. So she went assuming a beautiful form, so beautiful that although Nanda Maharaj's palace had many guards and a way to prevent an unknown person to enter, but Putana's beauty enchanted everyone so much that nobody dared to stop her. Nobody even thought of stopping her. How can anybody think ill about a beautiful woman like that? Rather, they started to wonder, is this Lakshmi Devi? Or is this Parvati? Is this Indra's wife, Shachi? So they just kept on wondering, who is this? This kind of beauty has never been perceived anywhere in this world. And Putana, in her extremely beautiful form, walked straight into the inside of Nanda Maharaj's palace. Came to Krishna and said, I heard, Yashoda Mai, that you gave birth to a beautiful little child, let me see him. And Mother Yashoda also began to wonder, who is this beautiful woman? Without any suspecting anything, she said, yes, here is my little baby. So Putana picked the baby up and said, my milk is overflowing just seeing the sight of this baby. I'm feeling a tremendous urge to give him my breast to suck. And then she offered this baby her breast. But her breast was filled with poison, the most deadly poison, Kalkut. Krishna knew why she came. Krishna knew everything. And Krishna felt bad. The first one that I have to kill is a woman. But what can be done? So Krishna closed his eyes. He didn't want to see this. He felt bad that he has to kill a woman. And when Putana gave Krishna her breast, Krishna just sucked her life air out of her body. Through this act of sucking her breast, Putana tried to get rid of the child because she was in intense pain. She started to scream and she assumed her terrible form of a Rakshashi, demoness. Huge body, hideous beyond anyone's imagination. Krishna considered that if this big demoness fall, then many people may get crushed. So he made Putana run out of the village where there was nobody, in an empty piece of land. And there Putana fell dead. Everyone was in intense anxiety. They just came running, screaming, shouting, oh my God, what happened? This demon has stolen our newborn baby. Krishna was only 7 days old at that time. And then they found Putana, a hideous looking demoness. And Krishna is playing on her chest. So they went, they climbed up to Putana's body, picked up the baby, brought him back. And it is said that because Putana offered her breast to Krishna like a mother does, Krishna is so grateful that Krishna offered Putana the motherhood in the spiritual sky. Putana was liberated. Being killed by Krishna, Putana became liberated. And he got the position of mother like a dhatri, nurse, to take care of baby Krishna in the spiritual sky. Kamsa realized that now I can see anyone who could kill Putana is not an ordinary person. So now Kamsa could identify where Devaki's eighth son actually was. Then Kamsa sent one demon called Sakatasura. That was the time they were celebrating Krishna's turning to the side. The baby first lies on his back. But then after some time, it turns to its side. So that is also an occasion to celebrate in the Vedic culture. Then the next thing is the baby now learns to crawl on his hands and feet. And that is called Janu Chankraman, crawling. And so this is how different aspects are celebrated through different festivities. So it was a festivity. Everyone was called. See, the baby now turns to its side. And so such big occasion, so many guests came and so much to arrange. So at one point, Mother Jashoda kept baby Krishna under a cart, bullock cart. But the cart was full of utensils for transport. She thought it's a safe place, underneath the cart. She made a bed for Krishna and kept him lying there. Krishna was sleeping. At some point, Krishna just woke up and he just touched the side of the cart with his foot and the cart collapsed. And this cart was actually a demon. And demon came in the form. And just by kicking him, Krishna killed him. But everyone saw that the cart broke and all the utensils, heavy, heavy utensils, just fell, making a tremendous sound. And so everyone came running. Mother Jashoda was in anxiety that under this cart I kept my baby. And then when they came, she found that although the cart broke, but Krishna was perfectly safe. Nothing happened to him. Everything fell around him. Nothing fell on top of him. And some little boys were there. So they said, it all happened because Krishna touched the side of the cart with his foot. They couldn't understand how a little baby's foot touched the cart and the cart collapsed. And so then Kamsa thought who to send. So Putana is dead, Sakatasura is dead now. So Kamsa called Trinavartasura, another terrible demon who can assume any form. And said, Trinavarta, this little child is too much. you are the most powerful demon, please go and take care of the child. And Trinavarta considered that Putana came, Putana was very powerful. But Putana came assuming a form. Therefore the target was visible. So she was killed. Whoever killed her, and now what I'll do is I will go without assuming any form. I'll go as a whirlwind. And I'll pick this child up, go up in the high of the sky, high up in the sky, and then from there I'll drop this child. And that's how I'm going to kill him. So Krishna at that time was in the lap of his mother. And all of a sudden, and Krishna realized that what's going to happen now. Trinavarta is coming. After all, he's a super soul. He knows what's going on in everyone's heart. So he knew what was going on in Trinavarta's heart. So fine, Trinavarta, come. Let's have some fun. But he was worried that if he is on Mother Yashoda's lap, then maybe this demon will carry Mother Yashoda also along with him. And then the situation will be very, very precarious. So Krishna all of a sudden became so heavy, Mother Yashoda couldn't carry him on his lap, on her lap. So she felt, surprising, what's happening, but I can't carry this baby. So she dropped the baby on the ground, just placed him on the ground. Right at that time, Trinavarta came as a whirlwind, making the stone chips and Trina dry grass to fly everywhere. As a result of that, there was total darkness everywhere with the flying of dry grass and stone chips and sand and dust. Everything was flying everywhere. And as if the whole place became dark, and it was also hurting their eyes. And Trinavarta picked up Krishna and went up in the sky. And then all of a sudden, Trinavarta felt that this child is so heavy. So he couldn't carry the child. So he thought that, okay, I'll drop the child. But when he tried to drop the child, he released the child for to be dropped. Then he found that the child's hand is wrapped around his neck. He tried to take the hands off. But this hand of this child was like an incredible vice holding onto his neck. Trinavarta started to struggle. He was in extreme pain and he was in acute anxiety. Now all his strength is gone. He couldn't remain up in the sky. And Trinavarta himself fell along with the child with his arm around his neck. And he fell on a heavy boulder with a tremendous sound. His body was completely smashed. His life left his body. Mother Yashoda, seeing that situation, when the storm came, the first thing she did was to look for the baby. Everywhere it was so dark and everything was covered with the flying dust and dry leaves, dry grass. And she couldn't find the baby, so she started to cry like a cow that has lost her calf. And then all of a sudden they heard that sound, terrible sound. And they ran there and they found this terrible demon with a huge body. His body has been smashed, falling from the height. And Krishna is happily playing on his chest, baby Krishna. So in this way, Trinavarta was killed. So then Krishna started to grow up with Balaram. And these two boys were the source of joy of all the residents of Vrindavan. They used to feel as if this child has become the center of their life and the source of their joy. All the time they are so attracted to him that all the time they just keep on thinking about her. And whenever they get time, they just come to see this baby. And in this way, so many celebrations took place. One such celebration was Gargamuni, their family priest, was called. He came to give the name of these two boys. So Gargamuni told, look, if you do the... actually Gargamuni is the family priest of Vasudev. So Vasudev sent him. And so Gargamuni said that if we do the name-giving ceremony in public and Kamsa gets to know, then he'll suspect that Krishna and Balaram are Vasudev's son. So let's conduct this ceremony quietly in the Goshala. So they went to the Goshala and there Gargamuni performed the name-giving ceremony. First, Balaram was older, so he said, this boy will be he has been transferred from Devaki's womb to Rohini's womb. Therefore, because he was his name will be Shankarshan, because he has been attracted. Akarshan means attraction. Because he was attracted from Devaki's womb to Rohini's womb, therefore his name will be Shankarshan. He will be the source, he will be very powerful, he will be the source of all strength. Therefore he will be Balaram. He will be the source of joy for everyone, therefore he will be also identified as Ram. And in this way he gave the names of Balaram, Shankarshan, Balabhadra. Then he said, this boy, he appears in four ages, in four different colors. In Satyayuga, he comes assuming the white complexion. In Treta Yuga, he appears assuming the red complexion. And in Kali Yuga, he appears assuming the golden complexion. And now he has appeared assuming the dark complexion. Therefore, his name will be Krishna. So in this way, the name-giving ceremonies were conducted by Gargamuni. And so now the names were given, and then gradually Krishna grew to be 5 years old. And this child is very, very naughty. Therefore, he is known as, his name is Krishna. Therefore, they get the nicknames, like Krishna became Kanhaiya. Affectionately, they call him Kanhaiya. And he is so naughty, therefore, he is called Natkhat Kanhaiya. The naughty Kanhaiya. So, this Kanhaiya is the leader of his friends. And he goes around to different houses. And one of their favorite pastimes is to steal butter. And how they do that? The boys climb one on top of the other. And Krishna is the one to reach the topmost, go on top. Then he carries the pot, lowers it one after another through these boys. And in this way, lowering the pots, they eat the butter. And then they feed the butter to everyone. Krishna himself eats. He feeds all the other cowherd boys eat. And then the monkeys follow them also. So he feeds the monkeys also. And when the monkeys also wouldn't want to take any more butter, wouldn't want to eat any more butter, Krishna say that this butter is so bad that even monkeys don't want to eat it. And saying that, he would break that pot. And then the baby of that gopi was lying on the bed, so he would be sleeping on the bed, so Krishna would go and pinch him. And the boy would scream and wake up. The mother would come running, and Krishna with his friends would just run out of the house. So this was one of Krishna's favorite naughty pastimes. So this gopi went and informed Mother Yashoda. Now Mother Yashoda found it hard to believe, because when she is saying the time when Krishna did all this mischief, Krishna was actually sitting with her. So she couldn't understand why this lady is making this complaint. Could it be that someone else did that? And she is thinking that it was Krishna who did this. So she said that, look, Krishna was with me all this while. How can I understand that Krishna went and did all this to you? So this is Krishna. I mean, completely inconceivable. So the gopi, she was surprised. She was a little upset also. Yashoda, do you think I'm lying? Mother Yashoda said, no, I'm not saying that you're lying. But try to understand that Krishna was with me. So how can I understand that Krishna did all that? So the gopis finally said, okay, fine. Next time he does that, I will catch him and bring him to you. Mother Yashoda said, yeah, please do that. So the gopi was waiting for Krishna to come with his friends. And one day Krishna did come. And lowered the pots of butter, ate them with his other friends. Then he fed the monkeys, and when the monkeys also wouldn't want to eat it, he said, this butter is so bad that even the monkeys don't want to eat. And saying that, he broke the pot. And then he urinated on the floor. Then he went to the baby, pinched the baby, and when the baby screamed and woke up, Krishna was just running out of the house, running out of the room. This gopi was hiding behind the door. And just as Krishna was about to run out, she just caught him. So finally, I caught you, Krishna. Krishna says, please let me go, please let me go. I promise I'll never come back again to steal from your house. So she said, nothing doing. Your mother insulted me so much the other day as if I was lying. So today I will show your mother what you have been really doing. So Krishna started to cry, please don't take me to my mother, she'll get really upset, she will chastise me, she may probably even beat me up. and so nothing doing. So she put Krishna on her shoulder. She started to walk towards Mother Yashoda's house. She came to Mother Yashoda with Krishna on her back. Mother Yashoda, this time I brought your son. And this time I hope you'll believe me. Mother Yashoda started to laugh. She got really upset. I caught him and still you don't believe me? You are laughing? As if it's not a serious matter at all. The Mother Yashoda says, see who you brought. She looks up and she sees that it's her son. She couldn't understand how it happened. She could hear Krishna's voice ringing in her ears. Please let me go, please let me go. I promise I'll never come to your house. If you take me to my mother will chastise me. She'll probably even beat me up. I mean, she could hear it, but now she's seeing that it's her son. Completely embarrassed, with her head drooping down, tears in her eyes, she started to walk back towards her home. And then all of a sudden she heard Krishna laughing. She looks up. And it is Krishna. She said, Krishna, you are such a... I mean, you embarrassed me in such a way in front of your mother. Like you assume the form of my son. Krishna says, what to do? Somehow I had to save myself. So I had to do something. Anyway, this time I became your son. Next time you catch me and bring me to my mother, I'll become your husband. This episode of Krishna's pastimes is from Garga Samhita. So this is how Krishna was playing his pastimes. Not that Krishna was always naughty. Sometimes Krishna was very, very wonderful. One day, Krishna saw that a lady is vending fruits, saying, I have the best fruits in the world. Whoever wants these fruits, please come and take these fruits. So hearing that, Krishna thought of getting the fruits. And he saw that whenever somebody needed something to buy, they would take some rice or something and barter it. Those days there was no purchasing as such. Those days the system was bartering. They would give some grains or give something that the other person may need, and this is how they would exchange. So Krishna wanted to have the fruits. So he called that fruit vendor, Falwali. Can you please give me some fruits? And she came, and Krishna got some rice. In his small hands he brought some rice, and half the rice fell off while he was carrying. And she said, please take this rice and give me the fruits. This Falwali's heart already melted, seeing the beautiful child. She felt like she could offer everything to this little child. And she offered fruits, as much as he could carry, filled up both his hands. And she kept on walking. She found that the basket she was carrying, the fruits, was weighing very heavy. It's unusual. And she lowered the basket, and she saw that instead of the fruits, this basket is filled with the most precious gems. I mean, she was completely baffled, struck with wonder. Not only that, she walked towards home. She used to live near the forest at the end of the village. And she saw her house is not there. She saw there's a big palace. She felt maybe she lost her way and came to a wrong place. But then she saw her husband coming out dressed up like a king. And the whole thing became completely transformed. And it has been described that actually this couple became the king of that area, big landlord of that area. So this is how Krishna returns. She offered him just some fruits that she was vending, but her offering was so sincere, so genuine, that as a result of that, Krishna rewarded her in such an amazing way. So Mother Jashoda, after hearing these complaints, she began to wonder, maybe there is some truth behind what these ladies are saying. Because they can't be lying, they're respectable ladies, and why they should lie unnecessarily? So Mother Jashoda started to think that maybe the butter in my house is not tasty enough. That's why Krishna goes to steal butter from the other houses, where the butter is more tasty than my butter. So she selected the best cows, and she collected the best grass. She fed these cows with those very, very special grass. And she collected that milk to make the yogurt, make the butter for Krishna, that would be the best butter in the world. So she had that milk boiling on the fire, and in the meantime she was churning the yogurt to get the butter. And at that time Krishna came, and Krishna just came and put his arms, held his mother's leg. And so Mother Jashoda could understand why Krishna came. And Mother Jashoda also felt such affection that she stopped churning the butter, picked up Krishna, and started to breastfeed Krishna. Mind you, Krishna was 5 years old, and still Mother Jashoda was breastfeeding him. According to the Vedic culture, the mother should breastfeed the child as long as she can. Because it is the mother's milk that creates the character of the child. So therefore, the mothers in the Vedic culture has been advised to offer the milk to the babies even up to the age of 5 years. So Krishna was happily drinking his mother's milk. And then all of a sudden Mother Jashoda remembered that that milk was boiling and probably it was spilling over. So she put Krishna down and ran to take care of the milk. Krishna was quite shocked. All of a sudden he was so happily drinking his mother's milk, and all of a sudden his mother, deprived of his drinking milk, dropped him like that as if he is not of any importance at all, and ran to take care of the milk as if the milk is more important than I am. So first Krishna was shocked. Then Krishna cried for a while, See how my mother treated me. And then he considered that this milk was also for me. For me that you are taking all the trouble to boil the milk. And now that milk became more important than I am. So now Krishna became very angry. Okay, I'll teach you a lesson. So that's how you treated me. He picked up a stone there and smashed broke that churning pot made of clay. Then he went to the next room. He got that mortar in which they usually grind grains, the grinding mortar. He dragged the mortar near to that the place where the butter pots were hanging from the rafts, and he climbed up and he was trying to get that pot down. In the meantime, Mother Yashoda came to this room and she found the mess in that room. The pot broken, the water, the milk and the yogurt and butter just flooding the room, and Krishna is not there. So she came to the next room. And seeing Mother Yashoda coming, Krishna jumped out of the mortar and ran. Yashoda bhi alukhalad dhabamanam. Seeing Mother Yashoda coming, Krishna alukhalad. From that grinding mortar, he jumped out and ran. Dhabamanam. And Mother Yashoda also, okay, I'll show you, you naughty boy. She picked up a cane. That is actually for separating the butter from the yogurt. And she ran after Krishna. Krishna is running, Mother Yashoda is running. Finally, Mother Yashoda caught him. And now seeing Mother Yashoda with a stick in her hand, Krishna became afraid. And he started to cry. Rudantang muhur netram jugmang mrijantam karambhoja jugmena satanka netram. With the back of his hands, he started to wipe the tears and looking at his mother with the frightened eyes. Mother Yashoda felt that this, it's not good for to frighten the child. Maybe he's afraid seeing the stick. So she dropped the stick. But she felt that this naughty child must be punished, otherwise he won't learn a lesson. So thinking that, she decided to tie him up to the same mortar on which he was climbing to steal the butter. And as you know, Mother Yashoda tried to tie him up with a rope. But this rope was 2 inches too short. Not 2 inches, 1 inch too short, 2 fingers too short. Then she got more ropes. It's always 2 inch too short. So then Mother Yashoda became completely tired, completely exhausted. She was sweating. It took him such an effort, took her such an effort. So finally she managed to tie Krishna. Krishna thought, my mother is exhausted. Okay, now let her tie me down. So then Krishna allowed Mother Yashoda to tie him up to that mortar. And Mother Yashoda went to do her daily chores and in the kitchen. She thought, this boy, this baby will be tied up like that. And she said, let your father come and see what you have done, and he will untie this rope. Saying that, she left, thinking that this boy will be just sitting here tied up to the mortar. But Krishna didn't like to be tied up like that for too long. He thought he made that mortar fall. So when the mortar falls, it's like two wheels. And he is tied up to the mortar. So he started to drag the mortar. And he found a new game. He started to go around with the mortar, tied up to the mortar. And he went, and all the boys were there. They also started to feel very excited. Wow, Krishna, you found a new game. We'll also get some mortars and play the game like that. And while going around like that in the courtyard, Krishna saw that there are two big trees, Jamalarjun, two Arjun trees. So Krishna thought, let me go through them. And when Krishna went through them, he passed through, all right, but the mortar got stuck. Krishna pulled, and two trees just fell with a terrible sound. And hearing the sound, everyone came running. And they found Krishna. Those two trees fell, and Krishna is in the middle, unhurt. And that was the anxiety. What happened? These trees fell for no rhyme or reason. There was no storm, there was no wind, there was no thunder. How come these trees fell all of a sudden? Such huge trees. And they were afraid that, well, Krishna was there. Did he get hurt? He could have got crushed under these trees. And these little boys who were there, they said what actually happened. The mortar got stuck, and as Krishna pulled, the true trees got uprooted. And not only that, these two trees got uprooted, two divine-looking personalities, brilliant as the sun, they came out and they offered some wonderful prayers to him with folded hands. And then they went up in the sky. Some thought, these children already became such expert in making stories. Some thought, maybe there is some truth because this child is quite unusual. Maybe because of his pulling, the trees have fallen. So in this way, different people started to think, after all, the child is unharmed. That's what really matters. Now, who are these two divine-looking personalities that came out of this? Nala Kuvera and Manigreev, two sons of Kuvera. Once they were sporting with some apsaras in heaven. They were sporting in the water, naked, and completely drunk. Completely intoxicated. At that time, Narad Muni was passing by. And seeing Narad Muni, all the girls came and covered themselves. But these two boys were so drunk, totally intoxicated, that they didn't have any external consciousness. They just kept on standing there, naked in front of Narad Muni, totally devoid of shame. Shamelessly they just kept on standing there. Seeing them, Narad Muni felt that these characters are not qualified to stay in heaven. So let them take birth in the earth planet as two trees. So that they learn their lesson. They are standing unconscious, naked. So let them stand naked through storm and rain and sun and winter as a tree. So he cursed him, become trees, go down to earth and become trees. So then when they heard the curse, they came back to their senses. They fell at Narad Muni's feet. Please, please, don't curse us like that. Please withdraw your curse. Narad Muni said that my words are not going to go in vain. Whatever comes out of my mouth is bound to happen. But you will be born as trees in the house of Nanda Maharaj. And when Krishna comes, you will be delivered by his touch, by his divine mercy. And as a result of that, these two trees, these two personalities, Nalukuver and Manigreve, became two huge Arjun trees in the courtyard of Nanda Maharaj. Kuberatma jau baddha murtaiva jadvat taya mochito bhakti bhajo kritaucha tatha prema bhaktiṃ sakāṃ me prajaccha namok shigraho mesti damodareha. O Damodar, just the way you delivered these two sons of Kuvera, please deliver me also from this material existence. I don't want anything else. So, iti driksha lila bhir ananda kunde shaghoshan nimajyantam akkhappayantam. In this way, through his wonderful, wonderful pastimes, Swalilabhir, Krishna submerges his devotees in an ocean of ecstasy. Ananda kunde, nimajjantam saghoshang. Saghoshang means his devotees. So we can see Krishna's pastimes are actually designed or meant for drowning his devotees in an ocean of ecstasy. So, I wanted to cover Krishna's entire, mostly Krishna's Kaumar Lila from up to the age of 5. But anyway, I could not, there are a few others left, try to cover them tomorrow. Let me see. Krishna's pastimes have Kaumar Lila, Poganda Lila, that is 1 to 5, 6 to 10, 10 to 15. And then Krishna doesn't grow. That is Krishna's eternal form, Navakishore. So, thank you all very much. Today I could not invite questions, and today we could not, could not cover all the topics that I wanted to cover. But anyway, let us see how much we can do in next few days. So I'm also very impressed. I could see that all of you are listening with rapt attention. And that is my reward, that your undivided attention to listen to Krishna's pastimes. And so we can end with a little kirtan today. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna Hare Hare, Hare Rama Hare Rama, Rama Rama Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, 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 Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, 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 Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, 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 Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Nittai Gaur Hari Bol, Hari Bol, Hari Bol, Hari Bol. Jai Jai Prabhupad, 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 Prabhupad. Bol Premanande Hari. Namo Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Prasthaya Bhutale Srimate Bhaktivedanta Swami Niti Namine Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunnavadi Paschatta Deshutarine Srila Prabhupada Ki Jaya. Hare Krishna, thank you very much. So we'll have the kirtan also in the temple today. Hare Krishna.
Between 6 p.m. and 9 p.m. today, and Devi Radhika Mataji